Well, I'm very honored to be here. I will say, by way of preface and comment, that the historical event that we're celebrating tonight, 60 years, is in one of the more historical buildings here in Las Vegas. This is the gymnasium of the old Fifth Street Grammar School. In the 1950s, there were only two gymnasiums in all of Las Vegas. The Las Vegas High School gymnasium right down the street on 7th Street and this. And I was in grade school, and I was what you would call today a very seldom used reserve on the John S. Park basketball team. Dave Wells, he grew up here. He was an athlete at Las Vegas High School, class of 52. So we've got a distinguished panel here to kind of help us part that curtain of nostalgia and talk about what Las Vegas was like and what the practice of architecture was all about when each of these distinguished gentlemen came here to advance their careers. Gary, let me start with you at the end. What brought you to Las Vegas?
I was with my wife and children were in Connecticut, and from 1966 to early 69, and we originally came from Salt Lake City, and we were looking to where we're going to get established back east in this foreign country, or are we going to come back home to the west? And what little bit of investigation we did, it seemed clear that Las Vegas was a place that was growing, was going to expand, and even explode. So we got in the car and headed for Las Vegas. Arrived here in February of 69. By the way, it helped that I got licensed in Nevada before Utah or before Connecticut. So I'm sitting out there with a license in Nevada and Stuttgart to come on over.
Gary, was it love at first sight, or was Las Vegas, as it is for a lot of newcomers, shall we say, euphemistically, an acquired taste?
Some of both. We were intrigued by the opportunity and the status of the development of Las Vegas in this beautiful desert. But my wife Carolyn can tell you, one of the first things we did after we got an apartment was get in the car and thought we'd go out and picnic to Lake Mead. It was the middle of June or July. We thought, where are all the trees we were used to in Connecticut? Where's the shade? How can people be out here? We turned around and came back home. But it grows on you.
George, how about you? What brought you to town?
Well, I'm named Ben. I grew up in White Pine County.
Okay.
In fact, I remember quite well. I had gone back up there for, I think, 4th of July celebration. And in the park, we met these two young fellows who were politicians going around shaking hands. And one was Richard, and the other was Harry.
Once in a while you catch lightning in a jug, George.
Well, being a native Nevadan, we kind of wanted to come back after I'd been in the service and so forth, come back to our state of Nevada. And at that time it was either Reno or Las Vegas, and we knew that Las Vegas was very busy and growing, and so we took a chance and came here, and that's been crazy ever since.
Leo, how about you? What brought you here to the jewel of the desert here?
Well, in my senior year in college, and of course I had a career before, I decided to go back to college and get a degree in architecture, but anyway, I won a design competition for a visitor center for a historical monument here in Nevada, up near Gads. It was called the Theosaur State Park at the time.
Do you have any idea where Gads was when you won this award?
No, I had no idea. But anyway, Dr. Charles Camp was a paleontologist in charge of that, and he set up a design competition in several schools of architecture, plus Calais and others. But anyway, I won the competition, and my department realized that there was an alumni over here by the name of Jack Knight. And so they said, well, you want to go over there? And so they set up an appointment with me, and actually they gave me a job to come over here. And so we came over here in June of 1962, and they never ever built the park out there, Jack Knight, and put a cost estimate together, and the State Public Works Board and the Nevada Park System turned it down, and so as far as I know, it's still my job if they ever get the name. It's a 10-mile road going in there, just a dirt road going in with 7,000 feet.
Well, high. I know a good lawyer that might help you collect. Dave, I know you're a product of the Las Vegas High School, star in the Las Vegas High School football team, and maybe I'll ask you a little different question. How'd you get into architecture? I went to Las Vegas High School. I couldn't get through physics, much less something like that. So when did you develop an interest in architecture? How did that come about?
Well, you kind of hit the nail on the head when you said physics. I was in college my second year. It was a two-year school. And so I went around to get my grades because I had to transfer to something. I went up to my physics professor. He says, look, are you going into physics? And I was like, no. What are you going into? And I was thinking real quick, architecture. How does that? And he said, I'll tell you what I'll do. If you don't stay in architecture, I'll give you a C. But don't you dare go into physics. So I said, it's called negotiation.
Las Vegas, who was the premier architect or art form? Was that the Zeke Harris in those days?
Well, after I quit bumming around the nation for about 10 years, I came back here.
Okay.
And I was working out at the test site in the engineering department out there. That was very exciting. And they said, you've got to have some architectural experience. So there was Moffett and Hendricks, there was Zig and Schott, there was Jim McDaniel, there's probably some more in there. Jack.
How about Hugh Taylor? Hugh Taylor went around, wasn't he? Hugh Taylor?
Yes, he was getting his architectural license at the time. But the incubator for this group, age group architects, which are, please God, you're a lot older than I am, was Zig and Schott and Jack Hillman. You were Jack Hillman. Yeah, and such other names as George Yamamoto.
George, yes.
And he's no longer with us. And Thielen, yep. Bob Thielen, Dr. Bob, and others. So they were the incubators, they were the stalwarts that produced most of us.
Now, George, what was it like going through the licensing process? I mean, you had, what is it, NCARB or whatever it used to be called, and then you had the Nevada Annex because we're the second most active sizing state in the country, as I recall. What was it like? I mean, was it a difficult process? Did you have to establish residency? What was required before you were able to sign up and take the examination to get licensed?
Is that for me?
That's for you, George, yeah.
As any of these guys, thanks. Anyway, back in those days, you know, we just come out of college, most of us are out of the service, and anxious we could get a job pushing pencil somewhere. But what we were really interested in was getting licensed. And we found that was tough, and because it seemed like somebody had planted a ceiling there that the young fellows just couldn't seem to get across for a long time. But I do remember very well going to right near where your office was, Leo, there was a an elderly fellow, an architect by the name of Aloysius MacDonald. He was a Scot, I think, or from Canada, though, and he had lost a leg in World War I. And he was the guy that we had to go to get started. He filled out, he gave me the papers to fill out. His office is what intrigued me. There were birds flying all around, and he was just alone, and he was kind of guy. He always was carrying something to drink, and he'd say a few words and drink. And the place was kind of dirty, and papers everywhere, and so forth. But he was kindly. He took an interest in me, and that's how we got started. And of course, we had to take the exam. It was one of those things that the guys who wrote it in such a way that nobody could pass. And but anyway, it was people like that.
How many took the board with you when you first applied?
I don't remember exactly. I'm 84 years old now. You asked a tough question to me. How many I don't recall, but I do remember some of the faces. Jim McDaniels coming out, Jack Knight, and so these people. Yes, and but it was Julia Lucchese, a number of us. So I guess there was about a half a dozen or a dozen maybe of the young guys, and it was all guys in those days. I mean, that's a great improvement now that we have young women who bring the profession, but they were just guys. And but we looked at the system and finally made it over the line and got into business.
Anyone on
the
panel remember an old-time architect dating back in the 1940s, Al Warswick? Is that name familiar to you at all? Yes, okay. Al used to drive around in a 1947 Cadillac limousine, and I was always very impressed, and I was never tempted to join your honorable profession. It was always very impressive when I showed up with a limousine that would take me and my dad home when we were working downtown. Jerry, how about your experience with the state board? Is it similar to George's?
It's related, but I came a few years later, so my family was better organized. But what happened in my case, I graduated from the University of Utah and had been working for 7 years in an architect's office. So the day I graduated, I was ready to go take licensing. There is some, maybe more then than now, but there is some disparity among states. And Utah said, sure, you can become licensed here. Just go out and work for 3 years, and then come back and talk to us. And I said, I've been working. I'm ready. So then I contacted Nevada, and they said, well, honored your experience while you were in school. I should have graduated in 5 years. Took 7 because of my work to support myself and my family going to school. And they said they would recognize. They had 2 parts. One they called the junior part, and then and then the senior part. The next day, I left Salt Lake for Carson City to take the first half of the Nevada exam.
Was it only offered in Carson City in those days?
As far as I know. I left Salt Lake looking to see the world. We headed east to Connecticut. And the following year, after I got to Connecticut, I contacted the Connecticut board. And they said, great, we'd love to have you. Just show us your experience in Connecticut for 10 years. And I said, thanks, no thanks. And then I came back to Nevada, took the second half of the exam, and then the following year, got in my car, headed out there to start getting involved in architecture.
It doesn't sound like an easy process. Now, Leo, when you came here, did you find kind of a warm and welcoming environment, a little bit like Linda Johnson, come let us reason together, or did you feel that you were not particularly welcome because you might be a competitive threat to architects who had previously been licensed? What was your experience with the people that you first dealt with in terms of being licensed?
Well, it was very nice. Like I said, I went to work for Jack Knighton, and he had three drafts, and Tony Campanaro, who was very experienced, and Pat Porporello, who had a degree from USC, and then there was a young guy named Doug Ely. And, but, you know, it was sort of interesting. I don't know, I got to know Howard Brandis, who was an architect here, and Jack Miller heard of me, and it all seemed to be friendly. And after I worked with Jack for about 2 months, Harry A. Whiteley, who had an office just up the street from Jack's office there, bought one, his sole employee at the time, who was a structural engineer, contacted me and asked if I could work nights over there. And so I said, sure. And so I worked over there for a few nights, and I like working for Harry Hayden Whiteley. And so I went from Jack Miller to Harry Hayden Whiteley's office. And I worked for Harry for quite a while. And then from there, I got a job with George Tate. And I worked for about a year with George Tate.
Was that all you could handle with George?
No. That was a good experience. That was a very good experience. And so then it was along about that time when I got a license. And I don't remember that there were any complications with the license. I mean, it seemed to me it was a seven-part exam. And the only part of it that I had trouble with was history. But I had history with trouble with history all my life. But anyway.
Isn't that Sir Banister Fletcher that's supposed to be the great authority on the history of architecture?
Well, I don't know. There are a lot of great architects. But anyway, I passed everything the first time, and then the second time the next year, I passed the history part of it. And so I guess it was the end of 65 when I was at my certificate. Sort of went into practice right at that particular time. You know, this is a friendly town, and so what do you do? You know, you call up when there's no work here at all, and the last person you worked for was Jack Miller, and he kept sending you over to Zinnia Sharp's office, to over to, let's see, who else did he send me to? I wound it back to George Shane, and George, the big old tower building down there on the, it's called the Stratosphere Tower, I think it was. No, it wasn't Stratosphere, it was called something else. Anyway, it was like a tower. But anyway, it was up there, and it was similar to the one that's
Landmark.
Yeah, Landmark Tower.
Okay. Not like the Tower of Pisa, nothing like that.
But anyway, George and his partner Tom thought they had a really big win, so they hired me back. And I was there for a few weeks, I guess, and it just kind of disappeared along with all the jobs in the neighborhood out there. And so I was out of job. And so I called up Jack Miller's, not Jack Miller's, but Tim McDaniel's office. And John Mayer, who was a longtime employee there, answered the phone. And I told him my story, and he said, well, he said, I got a little job for you here. He said, if you want to start it out, he says, for a very prominent man here in Las Vegas. And his name is Lester LaFortune, and he owns the garlic shop in working in Rose Garden's company, and he gave me a few tips on how to talk to him when I called him, and it was a small house.
No trash talking, I'm sure, right? Yeah. I know.
So I called Les, and he said, well, and he was kind of rough on the phone, and he said, well, I'll tell you, you come over, and he said, and don't be late. And he said, and I'll look at you, and if I feel like working with you, I'll work with you. And so I got over there real early, and I waited there for him. He got off, and I did his job, and a couple of years later, he took me around and showed me a couple of pieces of property, and then I did what was called the Silver State Building, which is on 770 East Sierra. I'm super proud of that. And that's the Silver Beaver Building.
And it's still standing, too.
Yes, it is, yes. Yes. And they kind of ruined it by being when the air conditioner went out. I had it all stacked up in a big part of the building. It was invisible. And so then the air conditioning went out. The garbage company wanted to use all that space for office space. And so the mechanical engineer decided that he would put an inefficient system on the ground out in the back there or put something on the roof. And so I didn't have much to say about it. So there's like a great big box car sitting up on the roof. And so I hardly ever go to the building anymore.
And every person's professional career, whether it's architect or whatever it is, there's kind of a breakthrough moment where you get kind of a job that really gave your career a boost. Is there such a job or project that you could share with us that really was kind of a seminal event in terms of becoming what you did, having built most of the schools here in Southern Nevada for a period of a couple, 3 decades?
Well, are you talking about when I started?
Well, I'm just talking about everybody starts in a profession, whatever it is, but there's a point in time where it's just not another job. It's really kind of the main breakthrough, if you will, where all of a sudden now you're not just another architect, but you gain prominence in the architectural community, in the business community, and it's that building that gave you the boost.
Well, it was the school district. It was one issue. Rollers, one thing, another one, that. I got started rehabbing schools. But what happened was I got interested in school design. And at that time, in that particular time, it was a boom. Corps of Engineers was all excited. They were doing their thing. You couldn't go wrong doing that. The test site was getting ready for plowshare. That was a new off the lines. Let's see, Nellis was getting fires in for fire product training. So that was expanding. What could go wrong? On the street, you had Elvis, the Beatles, and all these guys in that pack. So I figured that's a good time to go in. And it wasn't any particular stage of kickoff. It was the build-up for the Second World War. And I don't know who up here said it, but there were 14 major hotels going up in the side. So what could go wrong? There was more work than you could handle. Even the contractor coming in and saying, hey, can you help? I got a client. And it just seemed I was interested in all of it, so it wasn't a particular time. It just grew. I did make the birthday a trademark. And my birthday, I had to do more than I did last year. So that was my stepping stone. And I'm bragging, I never went backwards.
George, is there a particular building or structure that you look back over your career and that's something that you're the most proud of, any particular building? I'm sure you're proud of everything that you did, but one that really kind of is special as you look back and always think about that with perhaps more nostalgia than the other buildings that you designed?
It's surprising how often I get that question and flounder around, can't come up with a very good answer, but I got a partner sitting in the audience here who's thinking, George, How about this job, that job?
But there is one that that we enjoyed a great deal. It's the LDS Temple. It was a project that was selected by a process, a competitive process.
Was this the one out in Hollywood?
Yes. But the reason I cite that one is because I've never had a project of that size nor that scope. It was the nicest project that I've ever had anything to do with. And I often think, and that's still standing, by the way. Most of the others, if they didn't fall down, they were torn down for some reason or other. So I think that's why I don't remember some of the others.
Gary, is there one particular building that you look back and say, my God, this was the most challenging, either because of the design, it was extraordinarily complicated, working with the engineers and the building owner were complicated, or some new technology that was being used for the first time?
As a matter of fact, there was, like been expressed here, there were a lot of things going on in those early years, in the 70s. By the way, I got an early appreciation for people, relationships, talking to people, getting to know. We came here because Carolyn's childhood friend lived here. Before long, she had an in-law who had a cousin who had something that had an architect's office. First place to work was at Mall, which was an interesting experience. I don't want to go through all that story. To get back to, there was also Luca in town, named Frank Wadley, and I was down there getting some coffee one day, and he said, "You're in here, you're busy." And I said, "I could be a lot busy." He said, go talk to this man. And he gave me the phone number of Lee Linton, architect. And over the next 4 or 5 years, Lee and I were up and down this trip, all kinds of great experiences, from circus to the Latin Hotel, to the Tropicana. It was an amazing, amazing time. But in terms of technology, the theater, the performing arts, which is now encased or enclosed in the what was the Aladdin, was a new dome type that hadn't been here. It was made up of triangular shapes of wood members to span, I forgot that exactly, 350 feet, something of that sort. And it was a beautiful experience. It had seating for 1,200 people, and the day that opened was with Milton being the performing artist. I went to our place over in Utah, I went to Fisher. But the building was great, it had challenges. Two things that I can say were unusual. One is that the entire fenestration was molded out of fiberglass and resin, and it was formed, and the shaped panels were anchored to the side of the building. Well, the week that they got the panels all set up, they only had the top anchorage in, and that was a spring weekend, and windstorms used to come through here. I went down to the Performing Arts Theater. Here's our walls flapping out here in the breeze. Now, once it was all anchored in on all four sides to each other,
It was sound, but during that, that step, it's very difficult. One other quick thing. Soils test, water test, all those things are taken for that building. And the building is shaped, you know, a dish shape comes down in the ground 7 feet, and then with the stage and all the activity beyond that. Tests were taken in, I think about December, and everything was great. Got the slab in and started the curb slab in. We started putting in the exterior walls. Showed up there one day and it was all filled with water. And what transpired is the pedestrian golf course, the dunes golf course, right across the street, just started watering the grass. It seeped down in and came up there. I don't have the performing parts of it. So great experience.
Leo, looking back over your career, is there a architectural style in your mind that is kind of your favorite? You know, we've got mid-century and postmodern and all of these kinds of things. Is there something that you look back as kind of your favorite period in terms of contemporary architectural design? And if so, what was the big break that you got when you broke out kind of on your own?
Well, I mentioned that Silver State building here, which was a four-story office building that was done with Vertran, for Vertran crew in a way, I don't remember that. But anyway, that was the name of the glass, the insulated glass, and it was mirrored on the inside, And but if you were to have a style of architecture, something just clean, simple, straightforward lines that just didn't, you know, no ornamentation or anything like that. It's just physically the form of the building and how it worked out for the client's needs. And that's the style of architecture that I practice all the time.
It's 7:20. Do we want to give the audience a chance to question these gentlemen? We could go on all night and share their experience, but please. Wait, what the president-elect's got one. All right.
So what's your license number, I guess?
Who stumped the stars? All right.
Mine was 214. That is also the address of our first office.
So that's how you can remember now, George. Oh, okay.
I got to have a crutch.
No, I got it. Okay. Leo, how about you?
456.
456.
David?
I know. Very, how about you?
I'm just a kid in this group. I was 545. But I also know that people like Zink and Sharp, I think they were selling.
Yeah. I think that was Walter Zink, wasn't it?
Yeah. He might be either that or up in Reno.
That's right, yeah.
What the state legislation was passed in 49 to create the State Board of Architecture. So I guess those guys go back to that date then.
They were instrumental in making that happen.
You know, a lot of the licenses were given to people on the state that were coming here to get hotels and other things. And so that's how the license numbers got up so fast there for a while.
Did the board require that an out-of-state architect who was not licensed in Nevada had to associate with a licensed architect in Nevada? Did not require that. Was there reciprocity allowed by the state board that if you were licensed in state X that you were automatically licensed here or could practice? How did that work out? Looks like you've got the answer there, George.
Some states, they vary. I think that's the key. They vary one from another. I remember getting some licenses in other states, and all they were, had to know was I had one in Nevada. But then other places that was on vacation, you needed to go and have rather strenuous examination. So it varied.
Was Nevada a reciprocity state, or did you have to come in and establish yourself?
It was, I don't think that originally in those days it was what we call reciprocity. It was more just whatever they were doing at that time. And later on, it became much better organized.
Well, please, you've all been very gracious listening to our college. We have to hear somebody like that. Please stand up and
really appreciate the panel. This is fantastic. When I started at KGA about 20 years ago, and I hope, it'd be great if Ed or George were here to talk about it, but I'd like to just hear if any of you have any kind of anecdotes about interesting stories. When I started there, they had just stopped locking the door at 8 o'clock. So if you were late, you get locked out, and you had to go buy donuts to get back in. And another one is that when you got done with your old lead holder, you know, or your old pencil, red pencil, you had to go turn it in to get a new one. So I don't know. I'd love to hear some of those old anecdotes.
Any interesting anecdotes, Dan?
Maybe I can just add this much of KGA, Triple Garlock, and. My wife has a bunch of sweaters that have KGA all over them, and she won't let me throw them away. I need to perhaps explain to you, we've spoken before of Tate and Dobreski. Dobreski was my first partner here. Well, as time went on, Tom Dobreski left the area to work in some other areas and traveled around quite a bit. Was very successful. He passed away about 3 years ago now. My wife has passed away about 2 years ago, and so we got together. This young lady sitting down here was Tom Russell's wife and my first partner. So that Kate G.A. Was connected with Tom Russell, and that's why she keeps those sweaters.
Any other anecdotes here? But
I can mention one thing about George Garlock. I was president of the chapter in 19, also the AIA chapter in 1972, I think. And that year we started the golf tournament, which is still going. I stopped playing long ago, but the golf tournament goes on. And what I remember about George was this arrogant kid coming out of the golf course and whipping everybody he could see. He was an excellent golfer.
Dave, any anecdote you'd like to share? You've been around here since the memory of man when I thought to the contrary. You've probably seen a few things in your time.
Well, one thing back Leo skipped was when he first came here, we non-architects, almost architects, incubator architects, were a very social group. And we'd go over to Leo. Actually, Sue's house, or Phelan's house, or our house, or any of those, because we were so damn broke that we'd sponge off the other guy. In all seriousness, in those days, there were some people, architects, I think we ought to recognize the names. Of course, Thick and Sharp, and Bill Simpson, Wade's dad. He was a classmate of mine on the football team and NU. John Bearish was an artist architect, a tremendous artist. Jack Knight, somebody said, worked for him. He passed away. Jim Jimmy McDaniels did a lot of state work and was the design architect in the community, and he passed away. Ralph Bond was an architect that ended up being the county architect, and George Animato came to our group. Arturo Cambero was in our group, Jack Miller's. Jerry Strato, I don't know if anybody remembers his name, but Zick and Shot, Ed Hendricks, and MLC Brunner. You mentioned Borswick and Brunner. They were one of the first architects in the valley, and I just thought I'd take a couple of minutes and go over those. Those are all deceased, and I skipped them. I'm not perfect.
We called Ira Marshak, Ira Swamp Hut.
Gentlemen, you represent a different generation of architects. There are a lot of people out here that are a bit younger. Do you think you had more fun in the profession as you were going along than these younger men and women who are architects today that are growing up in a very different business climate, a very different world? Any thoughts? Sounds like you guys have some fun as well as working hard and experiencing a lot of pressure.
Yeah. I mean, just make a comment. I don't know if it was more fun or just a different kind of challenge. In those days, you design something. You'd go down to the planning department, talk to Jay Downey, and you'd go to the building department, get it stamped, and you go out and give it to contractor to build it. Today, it spends weeks and months going through regulatory processes. Well, just for me, it's very frustrating. Young people think that's the way you're supposed to do it. Was the time that the process relied more on the architect, his license, his professionalism, his ability, and thus the project was sound and produced?
It sounds like you're saying that it's more challenging, there's more bureaucracy today. And is that your impression too, Leo? You look like you've got the microphone in your hand.
I've been out of it for 7 years now, so I really don't know what's going on, but I don't think there's been much going on in the past 7 years. But anyway, it has to get more complicated because you got more government controls over things, and of course you have professional liability, and those insurance companies are looking for all the protection they can get. And so, you know, mistakes happen, I'm sure, along the way. But I don't know, I wouldn't be somebody that would have any opinion on that. I mean, it was just a lot of hard work all the time, and you were just after it all the time.
Anybody else with some questions here? President, we've got a question there. Yeah. The question is, did any one of these gentlemen, and I must tell you the statute of limitations is run, so you can feel free to be as candid as you want, had an offer to work with the mob or anyone, and Howard Hughes' name came up, not a member of the mob, but certainly a fellow with some eccentricity from what I've heard.
One project we had did have a connection there, that was the Landmark Tower, and it was kind of interesting. You mentioned an architect, Lee Linton. He was a true character. He wore a coat with fur collar, great big Cuban cigars, and I don't know that he had a real, at that time anyway, a real office. But he could be, you'd find him out on the strip at midnight, something like that. And
with a client who's sitting there, and he's making sketches all over the tablecloth. And great stuff, by the way. And you do this, and boy, you sell a project. But then, at that time, at least, he didn't have an office tour to actually produce drawings and things. So he came to us, our little firm that just got started, and he said, I've got this project going, and I need a whole bunch of finance so we go to work. He says, I'll tell you what, I'll give you $5,000 if you guys will crank out these plans by, he made the date something like 3 weeks away. So we worked like around the clock, killed ourselves off, got the plans done. And anyways, they built that project, then it was dormant for a period of time, but it was made with, it was built from the money from back east, from the mall, yeah. And they sent out, what was the union at? Anyway, they sent out a guy.
Probably the Teamsters Union, maybe? Is that the Teamsters Union or the Central States Pension Fund?
Yeah. Yes, it was. In fact, they had departments on that project. They required that they put one guy on the tractor to drive forward, get off, and the other guy get up, drive back. That's what they had those, that kind of rules, and there was an enforcer. He was a fellow who had lost part of his arm, and for some reason or other, he carried a little hose and he'd keep whacking himself on the arm. And you think, this guy is really weird. But quite a few people ended up in the desert, you know, an interior designer. Seriously, they got beat up on that job. But then the finances ended, the building was closed for a while, and then along came some guy who was interested in buying it. Well, that was Howard Hughes, and but it was not Howard Hughes that I met, of course, but there was another person who wanted the architect to go through the building with him, and he kept checking everything off, he counted silverware and everything. And I noticed it was strange, because when we approached, he gave the guard one name, and then we went a little ways, and he gave somebody else another name. Who is this guy? But at any rate, yeah, Howard Hughes did purchase that among his other projects, but it was a security job.
Jenny, we have a question over here. Somebody have a question? Yes, yes.
I just was thinking, when you said you worked for Harris Sharp and Walter Zick, if you remember, one of the stories I liked best when I worked for them a lot of years as well. And I wondered if you remembered any of this, that Buster Ballinger and Jimmy Little worked there, you probably remember. But I remember stories that when they were down on Main Street, that as draftsmen, they had to wear newspapers on their sleeves because the sweat would run off because there was no air conditioning or anything. Do you recall that being a problem at all when you guys worked there?
Anybody remember those days?
Yeah.
That experience?
When I first was in the service, I sent a letter to Jack Knight, who was the secretary of the AIA, said I'd like to come there at any jobs, and he referred me to Walter Zick, and Walter Zick said, come and later to me. And so I did anyway, working for them. It was kind of interesting because their office on Main Street had a front, they had a plate glass window, they put renderings out there. But then you'd go down the alley, and way back in the back, there were some kind of rundown buildings where all the draftsmen. That's where I was, the Ballinger's, probably the most fantastic draftsman I've ever seen. I don't know. Fellow named Ed Hendricks came from Southern California, did a lot of people for a divorce, and ended up staying there. But Ed was in the back room, and up front was Waller and Harris, had a nice office, and then a little better office belonged to their secretary. I don't know if I should give her a name, but she was an interesting person because she was the one that you bring the eraser up to, and she would examine it and go and borrow another eraser. And so there was at some point there was a conflict between Ed in the back room and Red in the front room, and Walt and Harris were out. By the way, Harris called me Boswell. He couldn't remember my name, but I filled the pop sheet, so I was Boswell. But anyway, Walter and Harris were out of town, and so Red was running the front office. And over the intercom, there's this big clash comes between Red and Ed. And Ed grabs his big drawing table puts up his arm and stomps out. He left the electric furnace and started his own, and I followed him after a while. But there were some, the thing that you're talking about there, they did have a kind of a stringent code of where, what their place was and what the two could do in that firm. And I'm not surprised about the sleeves there. But they were wonderful people. Veda had an interesting story where she's sharp. She's from Australia, New Zealand. Very pretty and very sharp. But she got into kind of a business and she was a doctor and whatever, and he had a bunch of ice cream stores all over the valley, and she would go around, kind of help him with his business, collect the money. One night, it was too late, they didn't want to put the money, so she said, well, we put it in the vault. So they stopped by the office and put the money, I think it was $10,000, which was a lot of money then, put the money in the vault. Well, the next day, Dr. Miller came by and picked up his money, and Red says, that's not your money, that's my money. And so they had a big court case, and Red won the case. And it was very surprising. I didn't see her for many years, and they ran into her at the State Board of Architecture in Western City years later, but I think they've all passed on now. That's why I tell that.
I'm sure we could go on for a lot longer. Do you tell me, have you got any other questions out there? When do we want to? All right.
I have one for you.
For me?
It's like your crowd. I know you all know that this is our illustrious senator. But has anybody wondered how the hell he knows all he knows?
Yes.
There's a confession he needs to make to all of you about why he is so in tune with our profession.
Well, the reason why I know a little bit about your profession, in 1975, I was a member of the state senate, and the legislature passed a very controversial bill at that time to license residential designers. Does that strike a responsive note? And let me say that the profession was not exactly rhapsodic about that. And so the legislative session ended, and I think Gloria Armendariz was the executive director of the Grand High Poobah, and yeah, grandson. Well, she was terrific. I enjoyed working with her, and I became the attorney, the State Board of Architecture. So I dealt with the likes of George Enomoto, Fred Dorio, Arnie Perhonen. Did these names strike a responsive chord with you? And then we had Jerry Poncia up there from Reno, and don't forget Arturo Campiero was on that board. Let me tell you, I had more challenges dealing with each of them because they didn't see eye to eye on a lot of issues, but I did learn a lot, and I certainly enjoyed the experience. That goes back a long, long time, but I was a pastor for about 4 years and enjoyed the experience. But I think we probably ought to, all good things have to come to an end, and I was told by Randy that every meeting of the AIA must conclude the same day it begins. And I'm not going to violate her direction. I think it's appropriate to give a warm round of applause and appreciation for four distinguished members.
For the Aladdin to
You go to see Latin, you go to jail, you end up being a fall guy. So there you go, an architect and a fall guy for the rest. So be careful of your clients. And then here you were talking about the building department. When I lived here in 81, the building department was in this building. And it was the equivalent of about three offices. So it wasn't quite as small for you, but it was just go talk to Hal and just stand the drawing room there. Last announcement for tonight is mark your calendars and don't forget to attend the March 31st publication reception for our April issue of the Architecture Las Vegas magazine. For those that you remember the Architecture Las Vegas magazine a few years ago, it's coming out again this year, two issues, April and October. The reception will also be the kickoff to April as Art, Architecture, and Design Month. It's being hosted by AI Las Vegas, Nevada Public Radio, and Christopher Guy's Showroom in the World Market Center, 5:30 on Thursday, March 31st. So mark your calendars. The other thing is I wasn't kidding about sponsorships. We have great sponsorships for every one of our membership meetings, and if you want to get your name